So the Romantic period, as our editors talked about, at least in our considering, is going to be the period from 1785 to about 1832, right? But I want to, before we even get into that, kind of discuss this notion, of an anthology in general. That's the kind of text that we are using in this course is called an anthology, and it means it is a collection, right? So an anthology is a collection of works, a compilation that is edited by a group. Our main editor, of course, is Stephen Greenblatt, but there are various editors for each different section. So if I go back, these are the editors for this specific Romantic period section. But I do want you to note that yes, if we are talking about very strict MLA formatting and you are for some assignment quoting the background, right, this Romantic period reading, you would give credit to the editors that are, that I just showed you. But just in general, we're going to give credit to Greenblatt because he's the overall general editor, and it can be kind of complicated to find the specific editors for each section. It'll start to make more sense, right, as we move along. So just always give Greenblatt the credit, and people who want to do more investigative searching can find those specific editors if they needed that. But I don't need that as somebody who's going to be grading your work. Okay, so the Romantic period, going back to our text, right? Our text is broken down into sections, right? And we saw that with the Romantic period. There are a certain number of pages, and within all of those pages, it is texts and biographies and background for the Romantic period. We are now this week moving into the Victorian period. So the first thing we are always going to do when we start a new section is read the background, right? There's no way to just dive into the readings without kind of understanding the context, what's going on in society at the time, what's going on in literature, specifically what's going on in the world, right? We can't really understand the things that we're reading from that time period without understanding all the things that are going on in life at that time. Okay, so I do want you to note that, of course, there is that difference between primary and secondary text. So the primary text are written during the period. So Anna Letitia Barbauld lived and published her work in the Romantic period, right? All those years ago. So that's a primary text, right? The secondary text would be the introduction by our editors, which are written, in our day and age, as well as those biographies. These authors didn't write their own biographies, right? We have experts and editors coming in now to kind of go back and create that biography. So again, we have a little bit more of an understanding of the time period and these specific people. Okay. So again, we have multiple authors, and every author does have a biography by our editors. Okay. You need to include in your reading journal entries all of this, right? So for example, in this upcoming week, we have the background, right, of the Victorian era, that introductory paragraph. And those can be kind of complicated to read. They're very dense. It's a lot of information. So make sure you're breaking those apart. Don't just sit and try to read all of it at once. That's just so overwhelming. So you need an entry for that. You need an entry for the biography of Alfred Lord Tennyson, which is also written by our editors, right? So we're moving into different kinds of readings with different authors. And then the actual poem by Alfred Lord Tennyson needs another entry, right? So start thinking of these entries as just separate readings, because they are separate readings that require their own information in that reading journal assignment. I note here that there are politics, right, associated with anthologies, because what you see in our anthology, which is the Norton anthology, is going to be different from, if you look at a different English literature anthology from a different company like Cambridge or Oxford. And I want you to know that there are a lot of choices that are made about who to include, who not to include, right? For a long time, Norton was on my list of publishers that I was not crazy about because they had a tendency to not include various voices. There were a lot of dead white men in their anthology, and not including, all the other people who were working to write at the time. We're always going to lose voices in the past just because some people weren't given the opportunity to publish their work or had their work even appreciated, right? But we have to understand that even though there were politics back then about who could publish, there are still politics today about who is included in these kinds of anthologies. These anthologies kind of give us a sense of, oh, these are important readings and important authors, but they're still, subject to people's biases, right? And people's prejudices. So some people are not going to be included. So just so that you can think critically about the text that we're reading, it's imperfect. It's not perfect. Okay. All right. So I want you to also think about how you're reading. Do you have different strategies? Are you taking notes? Are you reviewing your work? The reading journal is kind of meant to help with some of that, to kind of force you to read in a different way, to be more actively engaged in the reading. But y'all, it's a lot. So I really suggest that you kind of work to develop whatever strategies work for you. Whether that is taking handwritten notes, if you have the electronic version of the course text, you can take electronic notes at Norton, and review those, because a lot of times in our quizzes, you're going to have questions directly from these texts and you want to be familiar. And I'm not saying you need to memorize information from the text, because sometimes the texts are complicated, but it does mean that you need to be familiar enough with the text to know where to turn, what page to find, so that you're not having to reread everything. That's a waste of your time, right? And your energy. So if you read and actively engage the first time and take some notes and know where to find that information, you're going to be a step ahead, and those quizzes aren't going to be really time consuming. They shouldn't be. Okay. All right. So digging more directly into the Romantic period, we are talking about 1785 to 1832. And I put the question here, how are the timelines of these eras decided? We get some of that information from that background, right? Some people would consider 1776, right, with the Declaration of Independence and the United States kind of developing in an identity and pushing away from British rule. Some people talk about just different days or different years in that era. Just for ease, this is the kind of period that Norton has determined, the 1785 to 1832. And here, from the text, right, the Romantic is also the sole period that is named after the literary form, right, the Romance, right? And see how I give Greenblatt credit here in the parentheses? That's fine. That's what I'm kind of expecting for y'all to do. This is the background. I am not always going to include page numbers just because some of you have different texts than others, and I don't want it to be confusing. But in some slides, I'm just going to include the page numbers from the three text volumes, so volume D, E, and F, not the major author's version. Either way, a lot of the readings are, you'll find the same information. I'm just giving you a note so as not to confuse you. So I do want us to kind of step back from the Romantic period and think about Chimamanda Adichie's TED Talk, which is really wonderful for so many reasons. She really wants us to understand, like I was talking about with the anthology, we don't want to see that anthology as a single story or the only version of who and what writing was important during these time periods. Our text includes those various authors, but we must keep those absent in mind. And ask, while this person was published and worthy of inclusion in this expansive text, who is not included? Who are those people who may be absent for whatever reason? And I put here, who was able to read, who was able to write, to publish, whose stories were seen as valuable or important, and why, right? You will not see, unfortunately, a whole slew of writings by enslaved or formerly enslaved individuals, because a lot of times, at least in the US, it was illegal for folks, white folks, to teach enslaved folks to read because there's power in that kind of knowledge. So white folks didn't want them to have that power. So we don't always have as many of those kinds of stories as we might for the white folks, right? Who it what There were some white folks who still struggled to publish, but not nearly in the same way that African or African American individuals did at this time period, or Native American individuals, right? So we need to think about, why are some of these people able to get published? And sometimes it just is because they knew the right people, they were affluent, they had the resources to do that kind of thing, okay? This is also why understanding the context or the time period is also important, so we can think about who is left out. Okay. So When it comes to romance, it can be kind of misleading. The genre, modern meanings are really more about, Harlequin romances, right? These very overly dramatic novels, right? And even films. So we have a different kind of view of romance. It, originally, romance in this time period was more about kind of pastoral settings, even, think of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table. That's considered romance at this time period. Okay. So the recovery from obscurity, this is from our text, of the medieval romances previously ignored by literary historians, that's what we really think of as romance. This is the period where those are texts that are recovered. And interesting, we'll see that in the Victorian era from Tennyson, because Tennyson is hearkening back to the genre of romance. So I put here, when we read The Lady of Shalott, when you read it this week, it reads as something that could have been written in the Romantic era, and that is intentional. I don't want you to be confused by it because that was not necessarily the norm in Victorian era writing. Tennyson was specifically, right, and purposefully choosing to kind of hearken back to that Romantic era of writing when he writes The Lady of Shalott. It'll make sense when you read it, okay? So I do want you to note that this is a time period of a lot of kind of chaos, right? So initially France is the model, right, for revolution, for taking back power from an overly powerful government or monarchy. But then they become kind of a warning because the French Revolution was really bloody and violent. The guillotine becomes very popular. So the French people revolt and start chopping the heads off of their rulers. And so that became kind of a warning and it started to make folks in England kind of nervous. It's also a big time where the shift is from England being a culture that is more based in agriculture and the growing of crops and foods and things like that. And this is where we really start to see a shift into manufacturing because steam power is starting to be harnessed. And that's where we get also a change in the landscape. So instead of seeing a bunch of farm fields and greenery, you start to see railroads coming in, right? Because of the steam power. And you also start to see cities go up that are more industrially focused. They're not kind of the quaint, more like villages, right? And you also have the shift in classes. You have the working class, right, the laboring class versus those who have the capital. So it's a kind of rich versus poor thing. And some of these changes meant that the abolitionist movement was unfortunately sidelined. More emphasis was placed on these changes than the abolitionist movement. Women in the Romantic period were not necessarily respected, or didn't have the rights. And I'm unfortunately solely talking about white women here because, of course, Black men and women living in England, although they had a different kind of experience, of course, than US enslaved folks or even US free Black folks. There's still, of course, a huge amount of prejudice, racism, etc., right? But women in the Romantic period were provided only limited schooling and were subjected to a rigid code of sexual behavior, and the blue stockings. Who are the blue stockings, right? That's from the chapter, something to kind of go back on. Those are the educated women, right? And then, of course, in literature, because of all those things that are happening in the Romantic era, means that schools are formed around authors. So groups of authors would come together and form schools, not in the way we think about schools, but just kind of groups. These are groups of people that are the meeting of the minds. Writers actually started leaving their jobs to become writers. Before this, you couldn't necessarily make a living wage being a writer. It was just always something you did on the side. A lot of people went into the clergy, right? They went into religious work, or they were farmers and agricultural people. And now we're moving into more of the manufacturing and more of the era where publishing can kind of lead to a living wage. Not much, but still. And at this time, poetry is just everywhere in England. It's one of those people. Regular folks knew poetry, right? So they would be familiar with some of the elements and some of the writers. We don't see that nowadays, right? Poetry has kind of moved out of importance, which is unfortunate because a lot of poets are right now are absolutely wonderful. If you watch the inauguration this year, Amanda Gorman may be bringing us back into an era of poetry, which would be exciting. But during this romantic period, poetry was definitely kind of just super important. All right, I'm well over what I plan to do in terms of time here. So I will pick up in our weekly instructional video with a little discussion of Barbal, just so that we can then move into the Victorian era in our work this week. All right, so move on to the weekly instructional video.